Hello, and welcome to the Lakeshore Records podcast, On Cue With. I'm your host, Alon Levitin, and in this episode, I had the pleasure of speaking with a very wise and talented man. Einar Selvik is a one-of-a-kind composer, poet, singer, drummer, musicologist, and all-around badass. We discuss Einar's composition process for Ubisoft's Assassin's Creed Valhalla, how his music ties into gameplay, Norse mythology and philosophy, common Viking misconceptions, Einar's work with composers Jesper Kidd and Sarah Schachner, animism, Viking humor, Einar's epic band Vårdruna, a mantra from Odin himself, Einar's highly anticipated Assassin's Creed Valhalla solo album, and much more. The Assassin's Creed Valhalla soundtrack will be available on November 13th, 2020 on Lakeshore Records. I hope you enjoy my conversation with Einar and learn as much from him as I do. Yes. Welcome, Einar.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much for joining us. It's an incredible accomplishment, Assassin's Creed Valhalla. I've heard some of your music.
Yeah.
Not all of it. Very wide-ranging, very hearty, there's so much meat and potatoes to discuss about it, and I just would love to learn from you today on this podcast. You know, I'm not so familiar with this type of music, and so I would like to, in some ways, it's a casual discussion, but if you don't mind teaching me a little bit about what you have done, because as you may know, you know, I'm American. We have a bit of a cartoonish understanding of Vikings and this mythology and all of that, whereas you are, I would say, for all intents and purposes, an expert of your traditions and your culture and these ancient traditions, that maybe you can give us a little bit of background about yourself, how you came to be interested in this more specifically, and music and your process, anything you'd like to share with us.
Yeah, sure. Well, I can start. My name is Einar Selvik, of course, and I come from the west coast of Norway, small inland island north of a city called Bergen. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. I guess I've been exposed to like a lot of history and sagas and stuff like that since I was a child. Had people in my close family who were they knew their saga literature. So I would get a lot of stories, and whenever we were on holiday or visited specific places, I would get like the story of what had happened here at some point in time. And as a kid, probably didn't reflect too much upon that. But when I found that interest on my own in my early teens, the interest for the Norse culture and mythology and all of that, I found that, a lot of those stories and images had stuck and I guess enhanced that interest or given me a sense of place in time or in history in that sense. So that interest is something I've been carrying around for a long time. And also, as a musician, I started out really, I was obsessed by drums. That was kind of my main instrument also for many years. That's where I started. I got my first toy kit when I was 3, totally destroyed it. I got a proper kit through musicians in the family when I was 7 or 8 or something like that, and quickly understood that I don't like playing other people's music, and that kind of was a driving force to learn other instruments so I could make music and play to that instead. And did lots of different music, often with a Norse theme, a lot of metal music in the beginning, for many years, I guess. And at some point, I don't know, I can remember early in my teens, I had this vision of doing something more in line with both the Norse tradition, but also in terms of traditional music. And I grew up with metal music and classical music and traditional music. That's sort of, I guess around 20 years ago, I kind of felt that nobody was interpreting these stories and these traditions on their own premises when it came to musical renditions of them, and so I wanted to do something about that, or had a need to do something about that. So I started studying what we had of sources for musical within the musicology of it, came across all of these fantastic obscure instruments that, yeah, almost nobody knew anything about it. So that's kind of where I started my main musical outlet, which is called Wardruna. Mm-hmm. Spent a lot of time digging into these instruments. That's, some of them I had to make myself because, yeah, nobody was doing it. Maybe a handful of people on the planet. And some of the instruments I had builders build for me. Started with that, diving into that. And it's, that being said, authenticity is of course important. It's important for me to study sources, both when it comes to the musicology of it, but also when it comes to the themes I'm working with, building on solid ground before venturing into the more intuitive processes. That's kind of an important rule. That being said, it's not the prime goal for me to make to recreate music from any specific time period. It's more about taking something old and creating something new with it. The starting point is always based on what we know, or what we think we know, at least. A few years into the, I think after the first release of the first Wardruna album, was contacted by the TV series Vikings, and because they, for the first season, they used quite a bit of the Wardruna music. And for the second season and onwards, they wanted to have that kind of those sounds more into the heart of the series. And so I ended up working alongside Trevor Morris on the soundtrack. Mm-hmm. For the show. And of course, they used a lot of Wardruna. And also, I ended up doing a lot of the stuff that goes on that happens in front of camera in terms of musical aspects, like anything from battle cries to drunken songs or ritual songs, or yeah, all sorts of things, songs for funerals and etc. Even appeared in two of the episodes, also performing myself. This is kind of the world I've been diving into for the last 20 or so years. So when Assassin's Creed approached me, they had already been using quite a bit of my music in as the temporary music at that point. And it made sense. And also, because I get asked to do all sorts of things, and I've been asked to contribute on games before as well. But I don't know. I am a bit picky. I think that's important as well. I think if I'm gonna dedicate myself into something, it needs to have a desire to try and have an interesting approach to it, in terms of how the music is used, in terms of the overall seriousness of how they want to portray the time or the culture. Mm-hmm. The first meetings we had with Assassin's Creed was very positive. I got a good impression. And also they were like really creative, and they wanted the music to play a big role in the game, not only as the soundtrack, but more into the in-game stuff as well. Mm-hmm. Which is I guess where a lot of my contributions play out in the game.
I'm curious. There's so much to unpack there, but I'm curious. Do you have when we're referencing the musicology? Are there actual recordings that you reference, or No. Is there anything? Is it because you have the instrumentation? Is it all via oral traditions passed down?
Well, it's a jigsaw, I have to say, and of course we can't know for sure 100%. What music sounded like in Viking Age or Migration Period or Bronze Age, we can't know for sure. But there are many small pieces. So you need, first thing is that you need a broad overview of the sources. And luckily, I do have that. And also luckily, I have a practical approach as well. Since I'm a musician, I can apply the practicality to the to these hypotheses made by musical archaeologists and so on. Some of these instruments actually never went out of use. It's a living tradition using them, and we know based on archaeological findings that even the tunings of certain instruments are preserved in later folk traditions and such, which we know have much more information about the tonalities, etc. Some of the instruments are so limited in what you can and cannot do on it. So basically, whatever you do on it, more or less, it will to a certain degree be authentic, like the long horse, the horns, the lures, Bronze Age horns that are all, these are instruments that are all locked to the harmonic scale. Mm-hmm. So basically it's the length of the instrument that define how many octaves you give, but the tones in between, they are locked. And of course we have the poetic traditions which have, we kind of know, we know a lot based on later traditions how certain poetic structures are linked to certain melodies and or rhythms. Both in Norway and on Iceland, we know they sang in pairs, like. What's it called? I lost the English word for it. Harmony, in harmonies. We have this term called tvisungur, two singing, which is basically singing in. We see this a lot in medieval music as well, not only in the Nordic region, but singing in parallel fifths or parallel fourth. Mm-hmm. So basically, it's a jigsaw, and certain things you cannot know for sure, but other things you can know within a quite narrow margin, I would say, also in terms of some of the stringed instrument that we have quite a bit of information about. Some of the instruments are drone based, so that again limits it quite a lot.
Are these farmers making it? Because you have bones, you have horns, you have, you know, the frame drums. I think immediately of a farm.
Yeah, well, yeah, of course. But, you know, even though we get this, have this idea that, about the Viking Age, that everybody was walking around with swords and axes going to war, that's only a small part of it. First of all, you have to remember that Viking is a verb. It's an action. It's something you did. And so defining a whole culture and tradition based on what a small amount of people did for a short amount of time is kind of wrong. Most people were farmers. Mm-hmm. And it's actually within the farming traditions that several of the instruments I mentioned that there is a living tradition of using sort of prevailed. That's in like the horn instruments, especially. They were used as means of communications over vast distances, whether you were on a ship it was a lot used a lot in out in the pastures and such by and up in the mountains herding animals, so it scaring off predators and calling animals. Actually,
that makes a lot of sense. I was going to ask you about the pulse. There's this driving pulse throughout all your music that is. You know, for me, it just stirs up something very, my eyes will open a little bit wider and I get a little bit more connected to the current moment. And I think, I think of all these instruments, they're mobile, right? You can move around with them. And when you say that you can herd animals or scare away predators, that really clicks for me because I can really hear that. And I've never thought in those terms. That's very interesting.
Yeah, and that's actually one of the things that fascinate me a lot with some of these instruments, that they have a layer of something. they're nature instruments. They have a really rich set of overtones, and that, of course, has an effect. Whether you perceive it consciously or subconsciously, it's there.
Yeah. And I have to say the same with your breath, your vocalization and this register, this like very round, rich register of your singing. Is that did you have to discover this voice?
I'm not a trained singer. I'm a drummer. So I'm I've never taken a song lesson in my life. And I guess it's something I grew into. I think I really found the joy in singing after I started doing some lectures and like talks in different on festivals or universities or doing workshops, stuff like that, and. There I presented instruments and I started to do fully acoustic, more skaldic versions of these songs. And I guess that process changed my relation to singing as well. It kind of demanded me to find that resonance, find my resonance and such. So it's been quite an intuitive process, I would say.
And the one example of the soundtrack is the Words of the Raven, which is an amazing song. Correct me if I'm wrong. My interpretation of it, which again is an English translation, so I'm reading the English translation, but it sounds to me almost as though this is the raven's bird's eye perspective on the battle.
Yeah, in a way it is. It's a dialogue between a man and a raven, and so the raven is is kind of also, but also the relation, ravens have always been this gateway between man and God. So seeking wisdom from a raven is something we see a lot in this tradition in many different forms.
So you bring up the gods or gods, which I would love to ask you about, because so when you read these sagas and these histories, are they stories? Are they literal? Does it represent a worldview to you that you actually apply to your daily life? Some of the themes that come through these stories or these sagas or...
Well, I would say in terms of poetry, I would say they definitely contain a lot of relevant wisdom, forgotten wisdom, things that, you have like great poems, Håvamål, which is kind of, it basically translates the speech of the High One, Odin. It refers to Odin, one of his names, which is kind of it's basically just words of wisdom. It's like 130 verses of words of wisdom for the farmer, for the warrior, and for the sorcerer, for the more esoteric sides of things as well. And a lot of these things are good. I would say they have withstand the tooth of time, in a sense that they are, a lot of the wisdom is still relevant. And of course, I'm very, very fond of animism, in a sense that I think things became problematic the second we took God or gods out of nature and put them up a different place, not amongst us. It kind of took away or disregarded it altogether. Basically, when we took the sacredness out of nature, I think that's where we started going wrong as a species. I guess that's those are the elements that fascinate me most. I don't care much about like swords and battles and sure. That whole macho culture. It doesn't. It's interesting, and it's of course interesting to read about and get a sense of a totally different time and a brutal time. But here and now, I find much more interest in the more esoteric or philosophical poetry.
I'm wondering if, with Christianity, man is like a god, right? But, you know, all the animals are subservient. So yep. within this sort of more polytheistic animism or this general worldview, is man on the same wavelength or the same, just like the raven or anything else, or like the mountain or the tree, or is it special, quote unquote?
I think, if we go to Viking Age, we're way past that. We had already moved away from that aspect of the animism, I would say. So, but if you go further back, I would say that I do believe, and you see indications that we view yeah, we view ourselves more as part of a circle rather than just observing it. But of course, mankind, you have to remember that old paganism was very much about controlling nature to survive in a way. It wasn't a romantic, no room for nature romanticism, yeah. I would say. Not a lot, at least. It was a constant battle to survive. And I guess that drive to control nature in order to survive, that immense drive that we humans have is perhaps what put us here in the first place. We kind of took it too far in order to get things convenient for ourselves and not necessarily regarding the sustainability of it all in the longer run.
This is what I find so interesting about the soundtrack, is that you have these great orchestral pieces, you know, Jesper Kidd, Sarah Schachner, and then you bring in this whole other world of influence that is just, it's like you're like a portal into something so fascinating that I don't have access to otherwise, but it's instantaneous, right? That's the power of music.
Makes me happy to hear. And of course, that's kind of a part of my creative concept also that I've been working with for the last 20 years that, like I said, it's about interpreting these things on their own premises, using relevant sounds, rhythms, words, poetic structures, sounds even, relevant. Sometimes I record in relevant spaces, whether indoor or outdoor, specific time of year, etc. The list goes on and on in order to bring the music as close as possible to the core of what it's trying to express. I guess that means that it gets a different shape. I don't work after a song structures. It's basically more allowing the song to take me where it wants to take me, rather than me trying to force it into a shape that's predetermined. Mm. So it's a little bit backwards. In some ways, you can say that it's the theme that's the composer, and I am just the instrument, in a way.
It's a little bit tangential, but Wardruna, your Healing Mountain, I believe it's called.
Yeah, Lyfjaberg.
I don't know how to say it.
Yeah, Lyfjaberg.
Yeah, I'm not even going to try. Lyfjaberg. It's a beautiful, I seen the video. It's gorgeous. Where was that filmed? I mean, it's amazing.
It was filmed on the northwest coast of Norway on a small island called Tustna. Very, very... yeah, profoundly beautiful place, and it was a powerful thing to film as well, because the song is about the healing mountain you climb, and of course climbing a mountain, whether it's a metaphor or in real life, it has a cost and it has a value, and the more cost, the more value. This was shot in May, and at that point normally there might be some snow up high on the peaks, but there shouldn't be much snow then, but then the day before we started the shoot, the weather gods decided differently, and basically we had to climb that whole mountain in wading in a meter of wet snow. And so, I don't know, the whole process of making the video became so aligned with the content of the song. We all had our battles. We had to fight constantly during that whole process. Yeah, so, it was kind of special.
That's great. That's cool. And you have, I believe you have a solo album coming soon. Is that correct?
Yeah, well, Druna is we're releasing a, or are you thinking about Assassins?
Both, right?
Yeah, both. So first there will be a solo album, and then in January there will be a new Wodruna album. So yeah, busy time. And of course, the solo album from Assassin's Creed will perhaps allow the listener to dive even further in than the main compilation release that is coming now. Very soon. Yeah. So the solo will display more of both the skaldic songs that I've been working on, and also the more produced songs. And of course, the music I did for everything I did on this game sort of start out with these skaldic songs. It's a lyre and it's a song, and each of the territories have their own, both in Old Norse and in English, and some are written specifically in Old Norse to fit the given the quest or the story where it unfolds, and some I basically use contemporary to the game, the time span of the game, and use relevant Old Norse poetry for that. So. And then we picked up a handful of these songs that we decided on building out to a more full scale produced version for special missions and places in the game.
I believe I heard that there are songs sung on the ships. Is that correct?
That is also one of the things we did was when you're on the ship, you can choose if you want the crew to sing along. So great. It's pretty cool.
Very immersive, and I'm very there's you know what I'm not familiar with. Maybe this is a conversation for another time. Is humor. How does humor fall, you know, because you think of this, you think of Vikings and you think of, you know, at least for us, like I said, we have a more kind of cartoonish view via Thor and all of the movies, you know, and Marvel and superheroes. Like, we take the gods and we turn them into superheroes and comic books, right?
Yeah, no, they are I think both in when you see mythological poems, but also especially in skaldic poems, it's a lot of humor, a lot of crude, how do you say, X-rated or R-rated, I mean, stuff, often about joking about sexuality or manhood, the lack of it, I would say humor is quite a lot part of it, but it's kind of our own fault also that a lot of this isn't coming true. Even in like a lot of the translations, the humor isn't very present, but in more modern translation, the ones that are coming out now, which dare to be more, because it had to be censored. Like 100 years ago, they censored everything that was unchristian in a way, or too unchristian. So the more modern translations of things have more. They write it the way it's written originally, and. Of course, in these versions, we see a lot more humor and, a lot more foul language.
I understand. Yeah, no,
more sex.
Yeah, and I think another underlying theme to a lot of it is a camaraderie, right? I mean,
yeah, like it's an honorary honor is central in the tradition.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very much. Even especially in terms of being honorable and even towards your enemies. Mm. Like there is a proper way to do things, and of course, and also the society is very ancestral based. Like their beliefs and the tradition is very much about ancestral cult. And so, what family you came from, and how far back can you trace the line, even back to the gods, even that kind of thing, because that determined your right to rule ultimately, for the elite at least. So that also meant that if you did something wrong, that didn't reflect only on you. It reflected on the whole family line. So that's kind of a responsibility you had to bear. If you were punished with a fine, it wasn't only you who had to pay it; it was your family.
Mm-hmm.
Like yeah. So that's kind of the good thing about it, because it of course really encouraged people to take that responsibility. Of being an honorable person. If you weren't an honorable person, it didn't go so well.
You have to take out your own trash.
Yeah. And also, it's an honorary. It's an oral culture. So the power of words, power of poetry and stories, that had a lot to say. So even if you made like libel poetry, which is shaming poetry about people, it actually worked. Yeah. And that was forbidden. You could be sentenced to death if you did that, because the consequences were potentially very big.
Wow. I have to look into it. It's called libel poetry.
Yeah.
I didn't even know it existed. That's going to be a Google rabbit hole that I go down.
And it's even like we have traditions that it's quite similar to slam poetry and like rap battling and stuff like that. We also have like really similar things in the Norse tradition, even
it's in
up
the game
until
too, right.
I'm not sure how much I know there has been some talk about it, but I'm not sure what ended up and what didn't.
Got it. Very interesting stuff. I'm conscious of your time. I'll ask you one last question. Is there any, and this is a tough one and I apologize. Do you, from all of your, the wisdom that you were mentioning from these ancient traditions, is there one little tidbit that you can give us to go away with, or that helps inform you?
That's a really tough question. I don't know. Well, for me, Odin is a fascinating character, both for good and bad, I would say. For me, one of the most the most important symbolism in some of the things he does, because he's a person that is willing to do whatever it takes in order to grow, in order to become wiser, like whatever it takes. And of course, when he learns the knowledge of runes, he hangs himself in a tree for 9 nights and 9 days, pierced by a spear, and of course fasting. I don't know. It's a verse from there, from exactly that description of that ritual, where it says "Shalver Shalven Mir," and that means "I give myself to myself." And it's kind of a mantra I try to live for as well, because it basically means that anything of any value comes at a cost. And so whatever effort you put into it, it will pay off in a way. What you give, you actually give to yourself in that sense. So that's kind of a mantra for me.
That is a good one. I will take that. That one goes straight here. Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you very much for that. And for your time, I could talk to you for hours. It's very, very interesting stuff. And it really
my pleasure.